Hey folks, how you doing? This is Shock, and we're going to do another Bible study. You guys really enjoy these Bible studies, and I love doing them, so the feeling's mutual. Now, this is going to be a really good Bible study. Let's get into John 17. And before we do this, don't forget to go right here at shockcanal.net and click enter chat room. Stop by our website, get some free MP3s right here, free audio Bible here, all types of free things. If you're a Christian woman, you'll enjoy this, Women of Virtue, down here on the bottom. If you're a Christian man, check out Men of Valor. What else can I tell you? Oh, also, check out right here, Raul Ries MP3 Audios, and then click where it says go to church, and you could have church live on your computer. So let's begin. Let's start with this awesome Bible study. I think it's awesome that we can read the words that Jesus Christ spoke to his disciples in modern times. So we have the very God that created the universe. He plants himself into the tenthly flesh of man, and he walks among us. Is this epic or what? And so we're going to start off here in John 17. Jesus is ready to go to the cross. And here's what he says. He's in front of his disciples and he starts speaking to his Father. And here's what Jesus says. He says, Father, the hour is come. Glorify thy Son, that thy Son also may glorify thee. As thou hast given him power over all flesh, that he should give, look, eternal life to as many as thou hast given him. So notice Jesus is saying that he is giving people eternal life. And this is life eternal, that they might know thee, the only true God, and Jesus Christ, whom thou hast sent. So notice Jesus is clearly saying that God sent him. And then he says, I have glorified thee on earth. I have finished the work, interesting, look at this, which thou gavest me to do. So it was God's will for Jesus to go to the cross. And now, O Father, glorify thou me with thine own self, with the glory which I had with thee, look at this, before the world was. Now, a lot of people that like to claim that their religion predates Christianity is going to have a problem because Jesus existed before mankind even existed. Jesus was around before any of the man-made religions. Notice he says, which I had with thee before the world was. So there wasn't even any man-made religions, and Jesus was already existing. I have manifested thy name into the men which thou gavest me out of the world. Thine they were, and thou gavest them me, and they have kept thy word. Now they have known all things whatsoever thou hast given me are of thee. So notice he's saying, now they have known that all things whatsoever thou hast given me are of thee. Like all the words I'm telling them, they know that it comes directly from God. And then Jesus says, for I have given unto them the words which thou gavest me. So notice Jesus is actually saying here that God gave these words to Jesus. And notice he says, and they received them and have known surely that I came out from thee, and they have believed that thou didst send me. Now this is interesting when Jesus talks about what he's praying for. He says, I pray for them. I pray not for the world, but for them which thou hast given me, for they are thine. And all mine are thine, and thine are mine, and I am glorified in them. And now I am no more in the world, but these are in the world. He's speaking of his disciples. And I come to thee, Holy Father, keep through thine own name those whom thou hast given me, that they may be one as we are. Look at that. Interesting. While I was with them in the world, I kept them in thy name. Those that thou gavest me I have kept, and none of them is lost, but the son of perdition, notice, Judas, that the scripture might be fulfilled. And now come I to thee, and these things I speak in the world, that they may have my joy fulfilled in themselves. I have given them thy word, and the world hates them, notice, because they are not of the world, even as I am not of the world. So it's interesting, Jesus is saying that his disciples are not of the world, and the world hates them because of the words that Jesus gave them. Then Jesus says, I pray not that thou shouldst take them out of the world, but thou should keep them from the evil. They are not of the world, even as I am not of the world. Sanctify them through thy truth. Thy word is truth. As thou hast sent me into the world, even so I have also sent them into the world. And for their sakes I sanctify myself, that they also might be sanctified through the truth. Neither pray I for these alone, but for them also which shall believe on me through their word. So notice Jesus is also praying to people that come to Christianity through the disciple, that they all may be one, as thou, Father, art in me, and I in thee, that they also may be one in us, that the world may believe that thou hast sent me. So notice you have the Father and the Son, and Jesus is talking about this, how we can come into fellowship with God. And the glory which thou gavest me, I have given them, that they may be one, even as we are one. I in them, and thou in me, that they may be perfect in one, and that the world may know that thou hast sent me, and hast loved them as thou hast loved me. Now it's going to get really epic here. Watch what happens. He says, Father, I will that they also, whom thou hast given me, be with me where I am, that they may behold my glory, which thou hast given me. For thou lovest me before the foundation of the world. Notice, Jesus was already pre-existing, even before the world was created. O righteous Father, the world hath not known thee, but I have known thee. And these have known that thou hast sent me. And I have declared unto them thy name, and I will declare it, that the love wherewith thou hast loved me may be in them, and I in them. Now, check this out. It gets pretty heavy here. When Jesus had spoken these words, he went forth with his disciples over the brook Cedron, where was a garden, into which he entered, and his disciples. And something very unusual happens here. Check this out. And Judas, son of perdition that Jesus was talking about, which betrayed him, knew the place. For Jesus oftentimes resorted thither with his disciples. So it was a place that they would meet, like sort of like their hangout where they would go a lot. Judas then, having received a band of men and officers from the chief priests and Pharisees, cometh thither with lanterns and torches and, look, and weapons. Now, if you look below this video in the description box, you can see a clip of this very Bible passage that I'm reading in the movie The Passion of the Christ. So what I'm reading to you right now, I think it'd be awesome if you click that link right below this video. And when you go to shotgunnow.net, it'll say Passion of the Christ. Click that and you'll see you can see the entire movie, Passion of the Christ, there. And it starts off, the movie starts with this episode here. Now, here's what's interesting. They're basically coming to seize Jesus. He knows it. And he knows that they're coming to seize him, and he's going to die, and they're going to put him on the cross. They're going to kill him. But look at this, the boldness of Jesus Christ. Jesus, therefore, look, knowing all things that should come upon him, went forth. So here, it's like these guys are coming to actually kill him, He knows it, and he walks towards them. It just blows my mind. And watch what he says. Jesus says unto them, "Whom seek ye?" Like, okay, who are you looking for? And he knows who they're looking for, but watch, he's protecting his disciple. They answered him, "Jesus of Nazareth." And Jesus says unto them, "I am he." And Judas also, which betrayed him, stood with them. So Judas is with these guys that are there, this big mob that wants to seize Jesus. Now, this is something very unusual here. We're going to spend some time talking about this. As soon then as he said unto them, "I am he," they went backward and fell to the ground. Interesting. It's like, to me, you guys can make your own decision on this, but to me it's like when he says this, "I am he," there's like this power that just basically overcomes these people, or I just can't figure it out. Like, or maybe they're like, they're afraid and they all back up and they stumble over each other. But watch this. He says to them, "I am he." They went backward and fell to the ground. It's like this power, like he's basically saying, "I am he," and this glory, this power just knocks him down. Then Jesus asked again, "Whom seek ye?" And they said, "Jesus of Nazareth." Jesus answered, and watch, look what his first priority is here. Jesus is so awesome, which is why I love him so. Watch this. He says, "I have told you that I am he. If therefore you seek me, let these go their way." Now, another thing I was thinking, and it's just something that's going across my mind here, is maybe Jesus knows that they were going to try to harm the disciples. And so what he does is he causes the mob to go to the ground. Because it's interesting, he asks them, "Who do you seek?" And then they say, "Jesus of Nazareth." And these people, the mob, falls to the ground, right? And they ask him again, "Whom do you seek?" Remember, they already answered that. So it's sort of like he's getting them focused on him. It's just something that I notice here. Jesus answered, "I have told you that I am he. If therefore you seek me, let these go their way." Notice, he protects the disciple. "That the saying might be fulfilled, which he spake of them, which thou gavest me, I have lost none." Now, this is interesting too here. Watch what happens here. Some violence breaks out. And you'll see this, you'll actually see this in the, if you go to shakanow.net right below this video and click Passion of the Christ, you'll see it on the menu there. You'll see where Peter, well, let me just read it to you. "Then Simon Peter, having a sword, drew it and smote the high priest's servant and cut off his right ear. The servant's name was Malchus." So notice, this is written, this is a historical event. You got the person's name here, Malchus. And it's interesting that he cuts off his right ear. I mean, you know how hard it is if you're going to swing a sword to aim that perfectly and cut off the right ear. So a lot of biblical scholars believe that Peter was going for broke. You know, he was going for the guy's head, you know, to take it off. And the servant tried to avoid it, but just couldn't quite avoid it, and his ear got cut off. So, notice it says, "Then Jesus said unto Peter, Put up thy sword into thy sheath. The cup which my Father hath given me, shall I not drink it?" What is Jesus talking about? In other words, he's like, look, I'm going to be crucified. This is what I'm here for. "Then the band and the captain and officers of the Jews took Jesus and bound him." And you'll see that in the Passion of the Christ link below. Now, let's go to this. I want to show you something. Right here in verse 11 here where it says, verse 10, "Then Peter, having a sword, drew it." Watch this. Way back in Luke 22, prior to this event, watch what happens. They're about to go into harm's way. Jesus knows that this mob's going to be coming there. This happened prior to the event that I just told you about, okay? Notice it says here, here it is. Notice here in Luke 22:35, yes, Jesus said, "When I sent you without purse and scrip and shoes, lacked you anything?" Like, in other words, when I sent you out really without anything, did you lack anything? And notice all their needs were provided for. They said nothing. We didn't lack anything, you know. But now look what Jesus says to them, because now they're going into harm's way. "But now," Jesus says, "he that hath a purse, let him take it, and likewise his scrip." And interesting, "and he that hath no sword, let him sell his garment and buy one." Now, this is one of the shocking things that Jesus Christ has said, and there's no way around this. He's not talking about a metaphorical sword, because it is true that in some places in Scripture, like in Revelation, it talks about a sword issuing forth, coming forth from Christ's mouth, of which he slays the armies of the Antichrist. And of course, we know that that sword is the Word of God. But notice here, this is literal material swords. This is not a spiritual sword. Notice Jesus says, "He that has no sword, let him what? Sell his garment and buy one." This is an actual sword. And Jesus says, "For I say unto you that this that is written must yet be accomplished in me." And so if someone's saying, no, that Jesus isn't telling them to buy actual swords, they're totally wrong. Because watch what happened. "And he was reckoned among the transgressors, for the things concerning me have an end." Notice that it is written, must yet be accomplished. But then look what the disciples say to Jesus. And they said, "Lord, behold, here are two swords." Notice, actual, real swords. And Jesus says to them, "It is enough." So, let's go back. But now you notice here, what happens is, Peter strikes the high priest's servant. So Jesus was not condoning violence. Notice here, Peter is instructed by Jesus to put up thy sword into the sheath. So it appears here that Jesus has no problem with people defending themselves, having a sword. But notice he's not promoting Peter going ahead striking the servant. And I do believe, just my opinion, that this could be a reason why Jesus told them to have a sword, because he knew that these disciples are living in the world. So watch this. They bind Jesus, and they led him away to Annas first, for he was the father-in-law to Caiaphas, which was the high priest that same year. Now Caiaphas was he which gave counsel to the Jews that it was expedient that one man should die for the people. It's interesting that Caiaphas had this little prophetic phrase that he said, that it was expedient that one man should die for the people. And it's kind of epic that that's what's happening with Jesus Christ here. So Peter follows Jesus, and so did another disciple. They're kind of following him as the mob's taking him. And they go into the palace of the high priest. Now Peter stands at the door outside, then went out that other disciple, which was known unto the high priest, and spake unto her that kept the door, and brought in Peter. Then saith the damsel that kept the door unto Peter. So now they start to recognize Peter, right? And the woman says, "Aren't you the one of the man's disciples?" And of course, Peter's terrified, right? Because he knows they're going to harm Jesus. So Peter denies Jesus. He says, "I am not." And you'll also see this in the video. It's a pretty sad part, but check out shotgunnow.net right below this video, and make sure you click Passion of the Christ and watch that, because everything I'm showing you here, it really comes to life in the video. "And the servants and the officers stood there who had made a fire of coals, for it was cold, and they warmed themselves." So Peter's there kind of mixing in with the crowd, warming himself also. "The high priest then asked Jesus of his disciples and of his doctrine. So now the high priest is there questioning God. Picture this. Jesus answered him, "I spake openly to the world. I ever taught in the synagogue and in the temple, whither the Jews always resort. And in secret I have said nothing." He's basically saying, everyone knows what I stand for. Jesus then says, "Why askest me thou? Ask them which heard me, what I have said unto them. Behold, they know what I said." Now they hit Jesus here. "And when he had thus spoken, one of the officers which stood by struck Jesus with the palm of his hand, saying, Answerest thou the high priest so?" Like, he's saying, how dare you talk to the high priest like that? But Jesus basically challenges the guy that struck him and says, "Look, if I have spoken evil, bear witness of the evil. But if well, why do you hit me?" He's basically saying, "Look, if I spoke evil, if it was not true, then tell me why it wasn't true. But if it was the truth, then why are you hitting me?" Now Annas had sent him bound unto Caiaphas the high priest, and Simon Peter stood and warned himself. They said therefore unto him, again they're recognizing Peter, "Art not thou also one of his disciples?" He denied it again and said, "I am not." One of the servants of the high priest, being his kinsman, whose ear Peter cut off, so notice he recognized Peter as the guy that cut off the servant's ear. He said to Peter, "Did I not see thee in the garden with him?" And again, Peter denies Jesus Christ. And when you watch the movie Passion of the Christ, or at least the beginning of that, which I showed you right below this video, as I mentioned, you'll see this part where Peter starts breaking down crying on the third denial. Then led they Jesus from Caiaphas unto the hall of judgment, and it was early, and they themselves went not into the judgment hall, lest they should be defiled, but that they might eat the Passover. Pilate then went out unto them and said, so you got the governor there, so you got the high priest and everything, and they're more like the religious people, and you got Pilate, who's more like the secular government. You got that? Now watch this. It's interesting that the religious folks, the enemies of Christ, the high priest, the Jews, they're the ones that are anti-Jesus. And here you have the government dude, Pilate, he's pro-Jesus. He actually has no problem with Jesus. It's interesting. And Pilate says, "What accusation are you bringing against this man?" Right? They answered and said unto him, "If he were not a malefactor, we would not have delivered him up unto thee." Then said Pilate unto them, you know, basically, I'll paraphrase, like, "Look, take him yourself and judge him according to your law." But the Jews want him put to death, right? So they say to Pilate, "It's not lawful for us to put any man to death." They're not allowed to do it without the government's, Pilate's approval. "That the saying of Jesus might be fulfilled, which he spake, signifying what death he should die." Then Pilate entered into the judgment hall again. So now he wants to question Jesus and kind of see if he's a bad dude or what's his deal. So Jesus is there. You'll see this epic part of the movie Passion of the Christ also. And he says, "Art thou the king of the Jews?" Jesus answered him. One of the things I like about Passion of the Christ is it's not like in English. They're actually speaking in the actual language that they said, and it has subtitles. So you'll hear Pilate say in his language, "Art thou the king of the Jews?" And Jesus says to Pilate, "Sayest thou this thing of thyself, or did others tell it to thee of me?" Pilate answered, "Am I a Jew? Thine own nation and the chief priests have delivered thee unto me. What have you done?" Pilate asked. Now, it's interesting, Jesus is speaking to Pilate not like he's just like a little wimp, like someone that's been taken captive by the Jews. He's speaking to Pilate with authority. Look what Jesus says. He says, "My kingdom is not of this world. If my kingdom were of this world, then would my servants fight that I should not be delivered to the Jews. But now is my kingdom not from hence." Jesus is basically saying, "I'm not of this world." And Pilate's probably his just Jesus is blowing his mind here. Like, Pilate's like, man, this guy, something is epic about this guy. Now watch. Pilate says unto him, art thou a king then? Jesus answered, thou sayest that I am a king. To this end was I born, and for this cause came I into the world, that I should bear witness unto, look, the truth. Everyone that is of the truth heareth my voice. Now, in the movie, which is interesting, Pilate, he's going through some struggles himself, right? And he's having problems with the people and all this, and he's under a lot of stress, and he basically says, you know, what is veritas, which is truth? What is veritas? Pilate saith unto him, what is truth? And when he had said this, he went out unto the Jews. Now notice, Pilate's realizing that Jesus is more speaking of spiritual things. Notice he's not trying to overthrow the government, whatever. He's a spiritual. Notice when Jesus is saying that he's a king, it's a spiritual thing. He's not talking about secular, like worldly. So notice Pilate comes out and he's on Jesus' side. He goes, look, I find in him no fault at all. Now, this is interesting. This is a very, very beautiful typology that I want to talk to you about. Pilate says, but you have a custom that I should release unto you one at the Passover. Will you therefore that I release unto you the King of the Jews? Every now and then our government, I live in the United States, they'll come out with like an amnesty where people that are in this country, let's say illegal aliens, they'll come out with an amnesty and they'll say, okay, look, if you pay the fines and all this, you can be a citizen. And they'll have things like that. Similarly here, Pilate is talking about this little custom that they would have where they would release one criminal here, but it backfires on Pilate. He's like, hey, you know, let's release Jesus. He says, you have a custom that I should release unto you one at the Passover. But notice, they release this guy that's a pretty bad dude, Barabbas. Barabbas was a robber, a thief. And notice, they cried all again saying, no, not Jesus, but Barabbas. Now, I want to show you something here, and please don't be offended, because Barabbas represents you and I. What's happening here? The sinner, Barabbas, is being set free. Do you see that? And who's going in his place? Jesus Christ. So what you have here is like a typology of the sinner, you and I, of course, being set free, even though we're guilty, but Jesus is being taken in and being punished, even though he's not guilty. Now, when you watch The Passion of the Christ, this part is very, very difficult to watch. They scourge Jesus, okay? And the soldiers put a crown of thorns. They're mocking him because they heard that he's saying he's a king. And they put it on his head, and they put on him a purple robe. Purple was like a color for like if you were a king, for royalty. That's the word I'm looking for. Purple, like the kings would wear these purple robes. And so notice they're mocking him. And this part's pretty sad here. I remember when I first became a Christian, I cried like a baby when you actually let this sink in, you know, what happened to Jesus Christ. And so what they're doing here is these guys, these soldiers, which are tough, tough dudes. I mean, these guys were brutal soldiers in battle. I mean, these guys were just brutalized. And notice there is a bunch of them surrounding Jesus, and they're saying, hail, King of the Jews, like bowing down to him, mocking him. And then full force, they're punching him in the face. Now, Pilate goes forth again, and Jesus is all beaten up. He's scourged, he's bloody, he's bruised. And he brings him forth again, thinking that the crowd would have compassion on Jesus when they see him just like a piece of meat there, shredded and bloody and bruised, his parts of his bones exposed, showing. He brings Jesus forth and says, I bring him forth to you that you may know that I find no fault in him. So picture this, and you'll see this part in the video. Then Jesus came forth wearing the crown of thorns. So picture this, he comes forth barely alive with the purple robe on, and Pilate saith unto them, behold the man. Thinking that he most likely they're going to have compassion on him, but look what happened. When the chief priests therefore and the officers saw him, they cried out, saying, crucify him, crucify him. Pilate said unto him, take you him and crucify him, for I find no fault in him. Notice Pilate's a good dude. He's trying to defend Jesus. The Jews answered him, we have a law, and by our law he ought to die, and notice, because he made himself the Son of God. Now, my belief is that Pilate experienced something different with Jesus Christ, something that he never experienced before. He sensed something about Jesus Christ. I believe that, because notice what happens when they say that Jesus said that he's the Son of God. Pilate freaks out, and notice, when Pilate therefore heard that saying, he was the more afraid. So he goes back in and he's talking to Jesus, and he says to Jesus, whence art thou? Like, who are you? You know, what is this all about? But notice, Jesus gave him no answer. What Jesus is doing here is he's putting himself out there like the silent lamb that is the lamb that is silent, that is going to the slaughter. And notice, this is just so epic. Pilate is trying to get Jesus to speak, and he's saying, speakest thou not unto me? Knowest thou not that I have the power to crucify thee and have the power to release thee? Pilate, I believe Pilate's a good dude here. He's not saying this to be mean to Jesus. This is my belief. Is he saying, look, you know, he's trying to figure out a way, in my opinion, to save Jesus' life. And he's like, you know, talk to me. And you'll see this in the movie. He's like, talk to me, you know, don't you know that I have the power to crucify thee, but I also have the power to release thee? He's looking for something that Jesus can give him that will get him out of this quandary where he doesn't want to crucify Jesus. But look at this, and Pilate was probably just blown away by this answer. Here Jesus is about to go to the cross. All he has to do is really give Pilate some reason not to be crucified, and the answer that Jesus gives just doesn't make sense unless Jesus is the Son of God. Then it makes sense. Look what Jesus says. And Pilate probably was just like, his mind was just totally blown. Jesus answered, thou couldest have no power at all against me, except it were given thee from above. And notice, it's like Jesus knows what Pilate is thinking. He says, therefore, he that delivered me, who's that? The son of perdition, Judas. Therefore, he that delivered me unto thee hath the greater sin. Now, Pilate, I think Pilate was convicted right there. His heart was convicted. He's trying to get Jesus out of this. But see, the Jews were creating a lot of trouble for Pilate, as you'll see in this movie, and Pilate's own neck was on the line also. He was trying to put down riots and things like that, and you'll see when you see the movie, it's a matter of fact, I want to tell you something. The guy that played Jesus was epic, but when you see the guy that played Pilate, what an excellent actor. They picked a really good guy for that. It's not like he's even acting. Same thing with the actor that played Jesus. When you see the way that I mean, it's I would say Passion of the Christ is the best movie in the world I've ever seen. From the beginning to the end, you can't stop watching it. Now watch, after Jesus says, "Look, you wouldn't have any power at all unless it was given to you from God." That's basically what he's saying. And from thenceforth, and from that moment on, in other words, Pilate tries to release him. But the Jews cried out saying, look, notice they're threatening Pilate now. If you let this man go, then you're not Caesar's friend. And what you'll see in the movie, which is accurate, this part where they're talking about Pilate having problems with threats from the upper echelons of the government of Caesar, Pilate's terrified of that because his own life's on the line too. And notice they tell Pilate, if you let him go, then you're not a friend of Caesar. Whoever so maketh himself a king, and notice Jesus is saying he's the king of the Jews, speaketh against Caesar. So Pilate's between a rock and a hard place. When Pilate therefore heard that saying, he brought Jesus forth and sat down in the judgment seat in a place that is called the pavement, but in the Hebrew, Gabbatha. And it was the preparation of the Passover and about the sixth hour, and he saith unto the Jews, Behold your king. But they cried out, Away with him, away with him, crucify him. Pilate saith unto them, and notice Pilate's actually interceding. This is just unbelievable. He says, Shall I crucify your king? And notice the chief priest, which is totally bizarre, they're supporting government more than God. Interesting. Interesting. The chief priest answered, We have no king but Caesar. Notice they're promoting government more than God, which is really bizarre. You got Pilate here who's really sticking up for God in an unusual twist, and you got the religious folks that are using government to crucify Christ. Just bizarre. Then delivered he him therefore unto them to be crucified, and they took Jesus and led him away, and he bearing his cross went forth into a place called the place of a skull, which is called in the Hebrew Golgotha. And it's really interesting, if you type in Golgotha on the search engines, it actually looks, the side of the mountain there looks like a skull. It looks like a face. And so where they crucified him and two other with him on either side, one and Jesus in the midst. Now, I bet Pilate was like really ticked off with the people that are forcing him to crucify Jesus. So look what Pilate writes. You would put the crime that the person did, like let's say they were a thief or a robber or a murderer, you would put murderer like on the sign, or you would put thief, robber on the sign above the person that was being crucified. But Pilate, to sort of, in my opinion, this is what I believe, that to give the Jews that had him put to death a little dig, like kind of just to pour salt in their wound, he put Jesus of Nazareth, the King of the Jews. And in other documents, you'll read where they approach Pilate and they go, Why didn't you just say, No, he's crucified because he was claiming to be the king of the Jews? And Pilate basically snaps at him and says, Well, what I've written, I've written. I believe Pilate did that on purpose. Well, actually, here, that's the next scripture right here. Look. Then said the chief priests of the Jews to Pilate, No, don't write the king of the Jews, but that he said, I am the king of the Jews. And Pilate answered, What I've written, I have written. And you could tell, like, Pilate's doing that on purpose to kind of, tick off the people that had him crucified. Then the soldiers, when they had crucified Jesus, and by the way, you know, I'm just reading over this. Then the soldiers, when they had crucified Jesus. Okay, I just read over that. But if you have a stomach for it, and if you watch, if you go right below this video to shockandow.net and click where it says Passion of the Christ, put an hour or so time aside where you're not interrupted, and watch that movie. I mean, I cried like a baby when I watched that movie. But you know, when you watch it, it makes you want to all the more please God. It just makes you fall in love with God more and more. I fall in love with God more and more and more every day. It's just epic. Okay, then the soldiers, when they had crucified Jesus, took his garments and made four parts to every soldier a part, and also his coat. Now the coat was without seam, woven from the top throughout, so they could sell it for good money, right? They said therefore among themselves, the soldiers, no, let's not tear it, okay, but let's cast lots for it. Let's kind of draw straws, you know. And notice that was actually prophesied. I want to read something to you guys before we go here, but in Isaiah, I want to read something to you. Isaiah was written well before Jesus Christ came to the earth in the tently flesh of man and died for your sins and mine. And look what it says, they parted my raiment among them, and for my vesture they did cast lots. Let's go to Isaiah 53, if memory serves me correctly. Check this out. You know, if you're an atheist or an agnostic watching this video, hey, we're glad you're here. I used to be an atheist myself, too. We're glad you're here watching this. You notice it was the highly religious people, the religious nut jobs, that were the enemies of Jesus. You notice that? If you actually read Scripture, the people that Jesus had the most problems with were the traditionalist religious nut jobs. But the sinners like you and I that were humble enough and honest enough to admit that we're sinners, they were his best friends. He would hang out with people. Now, he wouldn't hang out with people, by the way, that were anti-Jesus, but he would hang out with sinners like you and I that were honest enough to admit it, that were pro-Jesus. I remember I had an atheist in the chat room, and you can go to our chat room at shockandow.net, and I asked him this. This was written well before Jesus existed here on the earth in the tently flesh of man. And I asked this atheist, who does this sound like to you in Isaiah 53? And he goes, well, Shock, obviously that's Jesus. And I go, you want to hear something unbelievable? This was written before Jesus was even here in the flesh on earth. Totally blew him away. Isaiah 53 is totally a prophecy about Jesus Christ. Look at this. Who has believed our report, and to whom is the arm of the Lord revealed? For he shall grow up before him as a tender plant, and as a root out of dry ground. Notice, he hath no form nor comeliness. What does this mean, guys? And when we shall see him, there is no beauty that we should desire him. What does that mean? When they beat up Jesus, or when he was bloodied and his bones were exposed and he was scarred up and ripped up and cut up, this is what this means. When you looked upon him, there was no beauty. Remember how they despised him and rejected him? Look, he is despised and rejected of men, a man of sorrows and acquainted with grief, and we hid, as it were, our faces from him. He was despised, and we esteemed him not. Look at this. He's going to the cross. Surely he hath borne our griefs and carried our sorrows. Yet we did esteem him stricken, smitten of God, and afflicted. And when you go to shakanow.net right below this video and you click Passion of the Christ, this next verse is how the movie starts off. You'll see it on the screen. It's got a dark background, and all you see on the screen when it starts off is this. But he was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement of our peace was upon him. And look, remember how he was scourged? And with his stripes, we are healed. This was written before Jesus went to the cross, guys. All we like sheep have gone astray. We have turned everyone to his own way. And the Lord, look, hath laid on him the iniquity of us all. He took the punishment for your sins. The cross is literally a love letter from God to you and I. You've seen the shirts that are pretty cool where it said, I asked God how much he loved me, and he stretched out his arms. He said this much as he died on the cross with his arms outstretched. He was oppressed and he was afflicted, yet he opened not his mouth. He is brought as a lamb. Remember as he was silent when he was talking to Pilate? Remember when he became silent? He is brought as a lamb to the slaughter. And as a sheep before her shearers is dumb, you know, silent, so he openeth not his mouth. He was taken from prison and from judgment, and who shall declare his generation? For he was cut off out of the land of the living, for the transgression of my people was he stricken. And he made his grave with the wicked. Remember, he was killed next to two thieves, robbers. And with the rich in his death, he was buried in a borrowed tomb of a rich person. Because he had done no violence, neither was any deceit in his mouth. So who sent Jesus to the cross? God did it. Yet it pleased the Lord to bruise him. He hath put him to grief. When thou shalt make his soul, look, an offering for sin, for your sin and mine. He shall see his seed, he shall prolong his days, and the pleasure of the Lord shall prosper in his hand. He shall see of the travail of his soul, and shall be satisfied. By his knowledge shall my righteous servant justify many. Look, for he shall bear their iniquities. Your sins are forgiven, guys. This is awesome news. You put your hope, faith, and trust in the finished work on the cross. Remember the last words that Jesus said before he gave up his spirit? He said, it is finished. He says here in Scripture, Isaiah, therefore will I divide him a portion with the great, and he shall divide the spoil with the strong, because he hath poured out his soul unto death. Remember, he was crucified right there between the two sinners, and he was numbered with the transgressors, and he bare the sin of many and made intercession for the transgressors. If you guys have an hour or so, click right below this video, shakanow.net. When you're there, click Passion of the Christ movie, and check out how much God loves you and me. And I love you guys too. Thank you so much. I really appreciate it. This was a long video, but what can be more important than your eternal salvation? So I think you are very wise and intelligent, and you've got your priorities right to invest your time in things that last forever. Remember, if you can see it, it's not going to last. The things that you cannot see are the things that last forever. So God bless you guys. Have a great week, and Maranatha. Thanks for listening.